So let's talk about one of the many great teen comedies of the 80s. Well, one of the big ones from the mid-80s anyway. Ferris Bueller's Day Off, which is celebrating its 35th anniversary today. Big D's Entertainment Rankings and Reviews. So greetings, my fellow YouTubers, and welcome to Big D's Entertainment Rankings and Reviews. My name's Duel, better known to you as the Big D, and this time around I bring to you a review of the 1986 comedy flick Ferris Bueller's Day Off, released by Paramount, written, co-produced, and directed by John Hughes. Sorry, Matthew Broderick as the titular character of Ferris Bueller, a high school slacker who skipped school for a day in Chicago, along with Mia Sara and Alan Ruck. Now, of course, as Ferris Bueller, he regularly breaks the fourth wall to explain his techniques and their thoughts. This was a big hit and became one of the top grossing films of 1986. So let's get into the story. In suburban Chicago, near the end of the school year, high school senior Ferris Bueller fakes illness to stay at home. Throughout the film, Ferris breaks the fourth wall to talk about his friends and give the audience advice on various subjects. His parents believe he's ill, though his sister Jeannie does not. Dean of Students Edward R. Rooney suspects Ferris is a repeat truant and commits to catching him. Ferris convinces his best friend, Cameron Fry, who is legitimately absent due to his illness. Hypochondriac, which Ferris sees through, to help lure Ferris's girlfriend, Sloane Pearson, from school on the pretext of her grandmother's supposed demise. To further the ruse, Ferris borrows Cameron's father's prize, 1961 Ferrari 250 GT California Spider, and Cameron is dismayed when Ferris takes them in the car to spend the day in downtown Chicago. Ferris promises they will return it as it was. The trio leave in the car with Park. Well, they leave the car with Park at 10. Sorry, I'm getting carried away by this. Who promptly take the car for a joyride. So the trio explore the city, including the Art Institute of Chicago, Sears Tower, Chicago Mercantile Exchange, and attend a ball game at Wrigley Field, and their paths occasionally intersect with that of Ferris's father. Cameron remains worried, and Ferris attempts to cheer him up by joining a parade float during the Von Steuben Day Parade and spontaneously lip-syncing Wayne Newton's cover of Danke Schön, followed by a rendition of the Beatles' Twist and Shout, which excites the gathered crowds. Believe me, that part is absolutely very funny. Meanwhile, Rooney prowls the Beuller home, attempting to prove Ferris's truancy. Getting into several pratfalls, at the same time, Jeannie, frustrated that the entire school supports and will rally for Ferris, skips class and returns home to confront him. But she's surprised by Mooney's presence at their home and knocks him unconscious. As she phones the police, he gains consciousness and goes back outside, unknowingly leaving his wallet behind. When the police arrive, they are unconvinced and place Jenny under arrest for making a false report. Waiting for her mother to collect her from the police station, she meets a juvenile delinquent who advises her not to worry so much. The friends collect the Ferrari from the parking lot and home. I said there, sorry. Discovering many more miles on the odometer, Cameron becomes catatonic with shock. Back at Cameron's house, Ferris jacks up the car and runs it in reverse to rewind the odometer. This does not succeed, and Cameron finally snaps, laying out his anger against his overbearing father. Repeatedly kicking the car causes the jack to fail. The car races in reverse through the wall and into the ravine below. Ferris offers to take the blame, but Cameron declines the offer and decides to stand up to his father. Meanwhile, Mrs. Beuller arrives at the station, upset about having to forego a house sale, only to become infuriated to find Jeannie kissing the delinquent. Yeah. Alright, now you know what this means. The ending. Like always, you have 5 seconds to stop this video. Go to the description box below and fast forward to the time below to avoid any spoilers. If you've seen the movie already, in which case I'm sure a lot of you have, please continue on after the 5 seconds is over with. Thank you, and here we go. Okay, you've been warned. Ferris gets Sloane home and realizes his parents are due home any minute. As he races on foot through the neighborhood, he is nearly hit by Jeannie, who is driving their mother home. And she speeds out trying to get home before him and expose his lie. Ferris makes it home first, but finds Rooney there. Jeannie races into the house as their mother complains to their father about her behavior. Jeannie discovers Rooney threatening Ferris and thanks Rooney for helping return Ferris from the hospital. She displays Rooney's wallet as proof that he was the one that broke into the house, and Rooney gives up. As Rooney flees from Ferris's dog, Ferris rushes back to his bedroom to greet his parents when they check in on him. Finding him sway and overheated from his run, they suggest he might want to think about taking tomorrow off as well. As the parents leave, Ferris reminds the audience, life moves pretty fast. If you don't stop and look around once in a while, you could miss it. And then, during the end credits, a defeated Rooney heads home and is picked up by a school bus, where he is further humiliated by students. And after the credits, a surprised Ferris tells the audience the film is over and to go home. Yeah. Alright, end of story, my friends. So what did I think of Ferris Bueller's Day Off? I'm going to say that while I've seen it a few times, including just now, I will say it's an absolutely very fun movie, and I really liked it. I really liked Matthew Broderick's performance as Ferris Bueller. Yeah. The rest of the cast is really good. Alan Ruck playing Cameron and Mia Sara playing Sloane. Playing Ed Rooney, the dean of students, is Jeffrey Jones, who the same year this came out also appeared in the cult classic Howard the Duck. Look for a review coming soon. Jennifer Grey, who I believe would later go on to star in, let me see, yes, in Dirty Dancing the following year, played Jeannie. Let's see. And Ferris's parents are played by Cindy Pickett and Lyman Ward. We also have E. McClurg, who was currently at the time playing Bonnie Brindle on TV's Small Wonder, and then would later go on to play Miss Pay Poole on The Hogan Family when it was still known as Valerie at the time. Plays the school secretary. We also have Charlie Sheen in this. Ben Stein. And lots of others. We even get special appearances by Christy Swanson. Heck, even Louis Anderson. If you watch this movie closely. But anyway, this film is absolutely fun. I like the parade scene. It was one of the best moments from that movie. I will always remember this by. This film has become a big classic and what have you. So, I gotta say, it's pretty much a fun movie and what have you. Now, in 1990, there would be a series that would come to NBC, which would be simply called Ferris Bueller, if I'm seeing this correctly. Yes. But however, it didn't do so well. It got canned instantly. I didn't recall that show even existing because I was too young. Well, even so, we had a lot of good fun and the story's pretty good. John Hughes' directing is real good, and just about all you can get from it. You got lots of good music as well. So, would I recommend Ferris Bueller's Day Off? Hell yeah! This is a film you can't pass on. I'd say you need to check this movie out. It's fun. It's very funny. You're gonna enjoy it. I know you will. So, what are your thoughts on Ferris Bueller's Day Off? Please tell me in the comments section below. If you like this video, click the like button below, subscribe to my channel, be a part of the Big D Nation. And just a reminder, though, I was going to do some spoiler-free reviews. Those are on hold until Sunday, so you will get a spoiler-free review of Peter Rabbit 2, which I went and saw. And maybe you'll get a spoiler-free review of In the Heights as well, maybe. Just stay tuned and find out. But next time, I'll be bringing to you Raiders of the Lost Ark, which is also celebrating an anniversary. It's turning 40. So thank you for watching, and if you like this, you may want to check out some of these other teen flicks of the 80s. In the upper left-hand corner is my review of The Karate Kid Part 2, which came out the same year this film did. The upper right-hand corner is my review of the original Adventures in Babysitting, which came out the following year. Or if you want some more of the guy who played an economics teacher in this movie, Ben Stein, go to the bottom left-hand corner for the Wide World of Games shows episode on when Ben Stein's money. Now, I know that series, my series of that show, Wide World Game Shows is kind of on hiatus, but it will return, I promise. The bottom right-hand corner is about you can click to subscribe if you like rankings and reviews on movies, TV, music, video games, etc. Then I'm your guy. Thanks for watching. Until next time, I'm the Big D saying, see ya.